Bonsoir et bienvenue au centre parisien de la Fondation Terra. Je m'appelle John Davis, je suis directeur et c'est un grand plaisir de vous accueillir ce soir pour le tout premier dialogue de cette saison de printemps. I am particularly delighted to welcome our speakers tonight and the topic that they will be covering. I was thinking back well over a year ago when I first arrived in Paris as the director of this center. One of the first things I did was call upon Olivier Gabet and to introduce myself and to find out what kinds of projects were in the works at the Musée des Arts Décoratifs. And I was very impressed by all of the activities of the museum and hoped that we would have an occasion before too long to collaborate. And happily, the occasion of the exhibition L'Esprit du Bauhaus, which has just closed at the museum, gave us that opportunity to organize this dialogue. Those of you who were lucky enough to go to that exhibition, you may have noticed that it was organized in a way not many Bauhaus exhibitions are. It was organized around the specific atelier. The parcours of the exhibition went through essentially medium by medium, looking at the teaching of that particular medium and how it changed over time, very much underlying the underscoring the craft aspect of the Bauhaus system. And it's that aspect of craft that brings us to our other speaker tonight, Glenn Adamson, who in his work at the Victoria and Albert Museum and more recently in New York City at the Museum of Arts and Design has really been at the forefront of some new ways of thinking about craft and about design, particularly in a museum context. I think that our event tonight is very timely because we are witnessing a kind of efflorescence of interest in what is a somewhat newly described field of design studies. If you were in New York City a few months ago at the College Art Association meetings, there were more conferences that were organized around issues of design in that 1, 2, or 3 day span than I think we had seen in the previous decade at the College Art Association. And I think it just speaks to this interest that is very current. I would just mention one example of this heightened interest, and that is another exhibition that will soon be opening at the Kunsthalle Bielefeld called Partners in Design, Alfred Barr and Philip Johnson. And this is an exhibition that is also supported by the Terra Foundation. Tonight, we are turning to another friend of the Terra Foundation, Étienne Tournier, who is going to serve as the moderator of our discussion. Étienne has just been named to the post of Responsable des Collections Arts Décoratifs et Design at the Musée des Arts Décoratifs et du Design in Bordeaux. He has interest in Franco-American artistic exchange in the realm of the decorative arts in the late 19th and early 20th century, especially in the medium of ceramics. And I will now happily turn things over to him to properly introduce our speakers and give us a few words to frame the discussion.
Thank you, John. So first I would like to thank the Terra Foundation. So John Davis, Philip Tillman, and Constance Moreto, who gave me the opportunity to moderate this wonderful dialogue today. I'm very grateful to them, and I'm all the more thrilled that most of the questions that will be addressed tonight are related to my own experience as a PhD student working on decorative arts and my current position in a decorative arts museum. So this is a rather unusual event for the Terra Foundation, as the two speakers are not Americanists nor 19th or 20th century art historians per se, but have led their careers in the decorative arts both as scholars and curators. They're here to share their experience in France, England, and the United States, confront their perception of the decorative arts and design in a museum context, and exchange their views on the capacity of the museum today to undo borders between art and design. Former student at the École Nationale des Chartres and the École Pratique des Hautes Études, Olivier Gabet, started his museum career in 2002 as curator of the creative arts department at the Musée d'Art Moderne de la Ville de Paris. There he co-curated in 2004 the exhibition Paris Moderne Art Deco works from the Musée d'Art Moderne de la Ville de Paris. Early on specialized in 19th century decorative arts with a thesis on the cabinet maker firm Fourdinois. Olivier joined the Musée d'Orsay in 2005 with a in 2005 as curator in charge of decorative arts. There he created several well-uploaded shows, including L'objet son double, Dessin d'art décoratif des collections du Musée d'Orsay in 2006, and Le décorateur et l'amateur d'art, décor intérieur in 2008. At the Musée d'Orsay, Olivier was also responsible for the contemporary art program of the museum called Correspondance, involving celebrated contemporary artists such as Brice Marden, Annette Messager, Yanis Kounelis, and Pierre Egy. After 3 years at the Musée d'Orsay, Olivier joined the Agence France Museum as curator in charge of the decorative arts for a not yet existing and still controversial museum, the Louvre Abu Dhabi, which should open at the end of the year. Former Faucillon Fellow in 2003, Olivier has been continuously involved in scholarly activities as teacher at the École du Louvre and the Institut National du Patrimoine, and as a researcher with publications such as Un marchand entre deux empires, Eliphabius et le monde de l'art in 2011, in which he focused on the art dealer Eliphabius and his role as a diffuser of taste for 19th century furniture and objects. In 2013, Olivier Gabet was appointed director of the Musée des Arts Décoratifs in Paris, whose collections span from decorative arts to graphic design, textile, fashion and advertising materials from the Middle Ages to nowadays. The institution also includes a wonderful library that I'm sure you all know, and the Musée Nissim de Camondo. Since his arrival at the Musée des Arts Décoratifs, Olivier has organized several successful shows, such as Piero Fornasetti, La Folie Pratique in 2015, Korea Now, Craft Design, Fashion and Graphic Design in Korea 2015-16, and more recently, L'Esprit du Bauhaus, which we just talked about, which closed its door 2 weeks ago, and I'm sure we'll hear a lot about this show tonight. Glenn Adamson took a different path with a PhD from Yale entitled Craft Paradigm, the Studio Craft Movement and the Avant-Garde 1966-1972. Glenn has so far devoted all of his career to a new understanding of what he considers as craft. From 2000 to 2005, he first served as curator for the Shipstone Foundation in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. In 2005, he started to work at the V&A, where he became deputy head of research and head of graduate studies. He also taught the History of Design graduate course, running collaboration with the RCA. At the V&A, Glenn created modern and contemporary design exhibitions, including the major survey widely reviewed exhibition Postmodernism, Style and Subversion, 1970 to 1990, held in 2011. In close relationship with his reflection on modernity, Glenn Adamson continued his research on craft, understood as a subject of study, the process, and not as a category or a subdivision within the arts. His publications include Thinking Through Craft, 2007, The Craft Reader, 2010, The Invention of Craft, 2013, and more recently, Art in the Making, published last year. In 2008, Glenn also co-founded the Journal of Modern Craft, the first peer-reviewed journal dealing with this vision of craft. According to Glenn, craft represents the best expression of human activity, and as such, it should be studied and analyzed, not as threatened by modernity, but as itself a modern invention. Deactivating the hierarchy between art and decorative arts, Glenn's focus on craft releases new methods of comprehension, new ways of apprehending and understanding objects, both inside and outside the museum. In 2013, Glenn was appointed director of a New York museum whose name does not much reflect his approach to the field, the Museum of Art and Design. There he has been responsible for adding a new research curator position in collaboration with the Bauhaus Graduate Center and expanding the Artist in Residence program by engaging younger artists from underrepresented communities. He has supervised a rich exhibitions program in direct relationship with his research, including shows such as Pathmakers, Women in Art, Craft and Design, Mid-Century and Today in 2015, and recently created an exhibition on the Los Angeles ceramicist Peter Vulkos that is still on view until Wednesday, I believe. Glenn is now a senior scholar at Yale University, where he's co-curating an exhibition entitled Things of Beauty Growing, British Studio Pottery, that will be held at the Yale Center for British Art at the end of the year. So now that I have presented our guest, let's get to the core of the conversation, today's role of the museum in making bridges between art and what is considered as decorative arts and design, let's say domestic arts, or art seen as different from other expressions because of its usefulness. As stressed by Constance in the description of the conversation, a good number of museum exhibitions held in recent years have demonstrated a new interest in the relationship between crafted objects and the artworks produced by the avant-garde, and more broadly, an increasing awareness on the roles played by objects in human action. L'Esprit du Bauhaus is one of these exhibitions that contributed to shed light on the works of celebrated modern artists through the lens of crafted objects, like any of those tapestries, for example. Glenn likes figures which cause useful confusion. Artists who, because of their status, the place where they show their works, and the type of materials and techniques they use, contribute to blur the boundaries between art and design. When designing furniture, I believe that Donald Judd represents one of these figures that causes useful confusion. I'm currently working with Constance Rubini on the preparation of an exhibition devoted to the relation between colors and design, in which this corner chair that you have here made out of painted aluminum will be exhibited. And one of the questions was how to talk about Judd's approach to colors if we don't show the whole process, to which colors he had access and why. The kind of information which, as Glenn has stressed in the Invention of Craft, is often hidden when dealing with contemporary artists. Alongside the chair, we will show this collage with royal color samples, in addition to extracts from one of Judd's major texts on color. I'm, however, still a bit dubious about the visitor's reaction to this type of information and to what extent it enhances their understanding of the work on display. So I'm very much looking forward to hearing about both of your rich experiences regarding this question. Thank you.
Thank you very much, everyone, for being here. Thank you, Etienne, Olivier, nice to be here with you. And it's a real pleasure to be here at the Terra Foundation offices in Paris. I have a long and happy association with the Terra Foundation in America, but this is my first chance to have a visit here. So again, as I say, a real pleasure. I'm going to just offer you a few remarks, about 20 minutes or so, about specific museum encounters between art, craft, and design, and then a set of more general remarks about what I perceive to be possibly new opportunities or avenues of interpretation at the confluence of these three terms. I want to stress that this is in no way going to be a complete account that I'm giving you. And in fact, in some ways, you could say that the problem that is in front of us this evening is the problem of undifferentiation, in the sense that process, before it is given a label or a conceptual housing outside of the studio or outside of the atelier, really covers everything that there is to cover in the realm of creativity. The task of the categorizer, whether that has been an institution or an art historian, a critic, a publication, the task is to narrow the frame of reference to say that these are the things that we care about in this instance because we are only thinking about this as art, or we are only thinking of it as design or as craft. In the case of craft, for example, we will only consider this object with regard to skill, materiality, possibly functionality. In the case of design, we will think of it as an instance of problem solving. In the case of art, we will think of it as something that has been designated as art and therefore as participating in a discourse. When we say that something is installed at the intersection of art, craft, and design, really in effect what we are saying is that we are going to not predetermine or prejudge the terms on which we will engage with it at all, or perhaps we're just saying we're not going to predetermine that set of terms yet. We're leaving that open. And as somebody who curated an exhibition, as Etienne kindly mentioned in his resume of my activities, as someone who curated a show about postmodernism, I can tell you that there was a rich and dynamic discourse about this kind of deferral of judgment that occurred in the 1970s and 1980s. We could now be said to be living in, you might say, a post-postmodern moment, particularly in the sense that this sort of cross-disciplinarity or post-disciplinarity is the foundation on which we stand. But of course, that's sort of like saying we're not standing on a foundation at all, that we're on shifting sands, because after all, a discipline is a way, as I say, of narrowing the field. So what does it look like to exist as a curator in that kind of undetermined situation? I'm going to just give you a few examples of what I think are perhaps some telling or indicative adventures that have happened in museums, both in America and here in Europe, that have tried to address this situation in various ways, starting with a program called Please Be Seated that was begun at the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston in the late 1970s. And it's from this program that I took my title this evening, Please Be Unseated, the point being that we are dislodged from a secure standpoint. So this, I'm sure most of you will recognize, is the work of Wendell Castle, the great American furniture designer, probably the most successful individual furniture designer and maker from post-war America. And the reason I'm showing you this particular one is that it was one of the inaugural objects commissioned under this program, which was the brainchild of someone called Jonathan Fairbanks, who was the head of decorative arts at the MFA Boston at that time. This is another one of those objects called, which is by Judy McKee. So these both entered the Please Be Seated program. And as the title perhaps implies, the logic of this was that objects would be acquired by the museum, commissioned by the museum, exclusively for the use of the public. So you could actually park yourself on this object, whereas of course you could not sit on any of the other many, many seating forms that were on display. And Jonathan Fairbanks had encountered a lot of resistance to this program when first proposing it from other curators, particularly from conservators, who said that there would be confusion, mass confusion, among the audience because people would not understand which seats they could sit in and which ones they could not. If they started sitting in the Wendell Castle and the Judy McKee that were planted in the middle of the gallery, perhaps they would start sitting in the 17th and 18th century chairs that were directly facing them on the platforms. In fact, as it happens directly, the opposite happened. The incidence of touching in the museum actually went down precipitously when these objects were installed. The conclusion that at any rate Jonathan Fairbanks drew from that was that people had a hunger to touch and to use the objects that they were seeing, and that if that were sated somehow or addressed through this program, that perhaps they would not be in that state of desperation. But it struck me that that was a very interesting example to begin with, because it is radical simply by allowing people to use things for the purposes for which they were intended in the first place. As we know, that's not generally the way that art museums will try to institutionalize objects that they see as craft or design or decorative arts. So I'm just showing you here a very well-known example, which is Barbara Bloom's installation. New York artist Barbara Bloom created this installation for the MAK, the Museum for Angewandte Kunst in Vienna, using the bent wood furniture of the firm Tonnet and putting it behind a scrim so that one experienced it initially simply as a series of silhouettes, and then one could walk around the scrim and see the objects in their fullness as wood. And what I think is striking about this strategy is that it renders the object into an image of itself through this shadowing technique, which is also something the MAK did with their historic, extremely important collection of historic Near Eastern carpets, hanging them almost as if a set of packing cards, a set of playing cards had been thrown up into the air and had not yet landed. So drifting in the sky in pretty much every orientation except on the floor to be walked on. And so I would offer you these two instances, well-known instances, the Please Be Seated program at the MFA Boston and the installations at the MOC, which are led by contemporary artists, as opposing cases, one which embraces the functionality of the object to a degree that museums normally do not allow themselves, and on the other hand, absolutely and resolutely refusing the status of the object as function, and instead turning into image or spectacle or purely visual consumption. When museums more recently have tried to address this question, they've often done so through a secondary or intermediary layer of interpretation. And a good example of that would be the Cooper Hewitt in New York, which just recently reopened, I think at the end of 2014. What the Cooper Hewitt did as the National Museum of Design in America was to turn to their colleagues in digital design, which I think made sense for them because they are, of course, responsible for the display of product and graphic design and therefore have a very strong aspect of their mission, which has to do with keeping up with the progress of digital techniques in these genres of activity. But I think for many people, the phenomenon of the new Cooper Hewitt was very much about trying to navigate a set of physical objects in relation to, as you can see here, these very large screens, which were, apart from their size, not unlike the screens that they were walking around with in their pocket all the time. And I think you can see here a very transparent desire to connect what might be a rather remote collection from everyday people's experience to something that they are more conversant with, which is to say, touchscreen technology. So if one were to offer a criticism of this approach, I suppose it might be that although it's appropriate to do this at the museum, like at a museum like the Cooper Hewitt, it also robs the museum of the specialness and particularity that institutions like ours should have. In other words, it makes going to the museum too much like sitting on your sofa at home, operating an iPad. And it seems to me that under the heading of technological experimentation in museums, one of the standards that we ought to be applying is how can we use technology in the museum space in a way that enhances the traditional strength of the museum rather than simply replacing them or obscuring them in some way. So without delivering any sort of global view on the Cooper Hewitt's installation in that regard, I just want to show you an example from Brussels, which maybe some of you have been fortunate enough to experience, which is the historical collection of musical instruments set in a beautiful Art Nouveau building, I think formerly a bank. And it's a museum that you navigate not so much with your eyes, but with your ears. Has anyone had a chance to go there by any chance? A couple of you, okay. So you know that it's operated according to a digital headset that is based on proximity. So when you walk up to a collection of objects, for example, these early experiments by Adolf Sax, who was from Brussels and was the inventor of the saxophone, you immediately hear them without having to do anything except stand close. And what's more, you hear period compositions played on either that instrument that you're looking at or an instrument just like it. And so as you walk through the galleries, you have the experience of understanding the materiality and sonority of different types of musical instruments and also moving ahead through time from Renaissance to Baroque to 19th century music. And it's a very non-linguistic experience. It's entirely done through sound and through the stance of the body. It's something that the V&A has done a couple of times as well, including in a very well-received exhibition about David Bowie, which again people navigated by listening to people talking about David Bowie, interview material, and then of course the music that Bowie recorded, and people absolutely loved this aspect of it, I think because it entered their body. And in a funny way, it seems to me that this way of presenting design or craft objects, however we would categorize these experimental musical instruments, that seems to me to have at least as much to do with the way that the MFA Boston encouraged people to relate directly to their seating furniture as it does to the way that the MAC tried to turn objects into art-like experiences in the sense that it was an embodied, physical, manifested experience in the galleries. I also thought that since we were here in Paris, it was only right to show a couple of images from the Musée de la Chasse de la Nature. I assume many of you have been there, which is here in the Marais district. which rather like the mock has basically set loose a set of conceptual artists on its own displays. And the thing that I think is so interesting about this particular example is that it points to, in a kind of paradoxical way, the huge advantages of the fact that decorative arts objects are not very high status and might actually be of relatively little interest to the average visitor. And I think this was especially true, not to speak for them, but I think it was especially true of the Musée de la Chasse, because even by the standards of decorative arts and design collections, theirs was not particularly highly ranked. It was essentially taxidermy and hunting pictures. And so it's not something that you would, I think, find many people crossing the street to see. And so it's almost as if they threw their hands up in the air and said, well, since nobody cares about what's in our museum anyway, I guess we can just go crazy. And that's kind of what they did. So, for example, they would gently lay this taxidermied fox in an upholstered period chair as if it had just curled up to have a nap there. And if you've been there, you know that these animals are installed in such a way as to reflect on the natural behavior of those animals and sort of introduce this element of the great outdoors and wild nature into the galleries. Here's another shot from the Musée de la Chasse. So very interesting strategy, and one that I think really takes into account the original materiality and intentionality of the objects, and through a disregard of normal museum practice, almost literally revivifies them. And a last example I want to give you is that of the Pierre Charot exhibition, which is now at the Jewish Museum in New York. And this has gotten wonderful reception in the press and among visitors for its use of digital and, in fact, virtual reality interpretation. And I'm just showing you one installation here, partly because it is so obviously an update of the Barbara Bloom installation at the MOC. So again, what you see here is the use of a scrim and shadow play as a way to animate the objects on display. And of course, you'll know Pierre Charot from the exhibitions, the exhibition space here at the Musée des Arts Décoratifs, Olivier's institution. But what the designers of this exhibition, Diller, Scafidio, and Renfro, the well-known architectural firm, did was to animate the shadows, almost as if you were in a Javanese puppet show. And so you have the, it's a little bit difficult to understand this from a still slide, but you have the shadows of the furniture, but then you also had these characters who are only seen in shadow, who silently go about their business, doing their makeup at a cosmetics vanity, or smoking and leaning back and reading at a desk. And it gives this wonderful sense of a kind of period theater to these objects, not incidentally also returning them to a period of black and white, which is how we tend to experience works of the Art Deco period. And it makes you think about the fact that Art Deco is extremely high contrast, a lot of use of black and white and materials like Macassar ebony, precisely because it looks so good on screen in a black and white movie on the silver screen, and it sort of returns that cinematic logic to the objects on display. So that to me again is a use of digital interface or technological interface that in some ways is literally mediating your experience, but on the other hand seems to have a kind of physicality to it which is evolved from the logic of an art object or design object as a real thing in the world. I'm just going to give a couple of other examples from my own work recently that might help to give some examples of where we can take the conversation about how to bring art, craft, and design into people's lives in a more relevant way. And the first is actually not from a museum project. In fact, neither of them are from museum projects I've been involved with, but rather writing projects. So the first has to do with my role as an editor at large for the magazine Antiques, which I was asked to take on about a year ago. And you might say that they were in a similar position to the traditional decorative arts museum in the sense that they had a reputation for being rather fusty and old-fashioned and were experiencing declining readership, therefore declining advertising. And they wanted to sort of give themselves a kick in the seat of their pants, you might say, so they hired me to do that. And what I proposed to them was a column that would look at antique objects, historical decorative arts, explicitly through the lens of contemporary debate. So for example, the first column is about the arguments that are raging around the harvesting of elephant ivory in Africa. And so what I did was to talk about historic miniatures, like this one, which is a picture of the artist Gilbert Stuart, who painted, you know, famously painted George Washington, the image that we have on our dollar bill in America. But it includes a braid of Gilbert Stuart's hair that's been intertwined. And Stuart commissioned this this miniature of himself from a fellow artist called Sarah Goodridge, and then he gave it to his mother with his own hair attached. And I was very struck with the fact that the hair, right from the beginning, was an object of focus and emotional attachment and attention. But of course, there's another body part in this miniature as well, which is the ivory plaque, which obviously was cut off the tusk of a recently killed elephant. And I thought it was very interesting to think about an object like this in relation to an image like this, which is a shot from the largest ivory burn ever staged. This was done in Kenya just last year, just as I was going to press with this column. And this is one way that the governments, particularly in East Africa, have tried to cut down on the poaching of elephant ivory whenever they are able to reclaim the ivory from the offending poachers. They pile it in these huge pyramids in public squares and then torch the whole lot. And there's a lot of argumentation about whether this is the right strategy or not. People who argue against this say it only drives up the market price of ivory further when you take it out of circulation, for example. Very difficult to know what to do. But I thought it was very interesting to look at this historical artifact in relation to these contemporary issues. Similarly, during the summer, when there was a lot of conversation happening about police brutality and then counter violence against police departments, I wrote a column about this object, which was owned by the very first chief of police of New York City, whose name was John Matzell. And Matzell was the person who introduced regular uniforms to the New York City police and otherwise tried to institutionalize them and give them a more official air, basically taking them from a sort of informal street patrol to an actual official edifice of the city government. And he had this object made for him when he was chief of police. And as you can see, it's a sort of regular nightstick, but then it has a badge. We would think of it as like a sheriff's badge from the Old West that's been mounted on it. And of course, it looks like an incredibly deadly bludgeon. And I thought it was very interesting that he would, for ceremonial purposes, have this emblematic object made for him that could do serious damage if it were wielded as a club. And in fact, I found that Matzell had been in the thick of it during a major riot that happened in the late 1850s in the lead up to the Civil War, when the draft was on and there was actually an Irish against black riot happening in the streets. And he, along with several other police officials, was called to use his nightstick in deadly combat. And so it was very interesting to me that he had then had this made almost as like a military emblem. So the fact that today we think about the militarization of the police as a new thing, perhaps, this is an MRAP, which is a military armored patrol vehicle that was acquired by a Wisconsin police department as a military surplus. And you're seeing it here driving past a white picket fenced yard in rural Wisconsin. So this obviously is very striking to our eyes, but it's interesting to think about the fact that this would have been just as striking to people in the mid-19th century as an instance of the weaponization of the police force. In terms of other topics that I've been interested to take on in this column, one of the most important has been race. And I was thinking about an exhibition that I did for a while ago at the Milwaukee Art Museum, which was about this object, which is a portrait picture of the great Haitian rebel leader Toussaint Louverture. So it's actually a picture that you can pour out of, so it is decorative. It seems to have been made for abolitionist fundraising purposes in the neighborhood of Boston. And the exhibition compared that object with both African-American face jugs and also abolitionist material culture, like these objects with this famous emblem, "Am I not a man and a brother?" and a kneeling, almost entirely unclothed slave pleading for his freedom. That's the famous Wedgwood promotional plaque that you see on the lower left. And the larger object is a tobacco casket that has this emblem cast into its lid. And this was something that people would buy to show that they were buying tobacco that was clean in other words, not processed by slaves, but had been, rather as we would today with a consumer good, had been sort of come through a more morally virtuous commodity chain. And I think it's, again, very interesting to think about these kinds of artifacts in relation to conversations that we're having today about race, because you might say, well, from one perspective, they're sort of good guy objects. And if I go back to this picture, for example, this seems to have been made in an abolitionist context by people who were against slavery and we would see as, you know, certainly on the right side of history. But look at the stereotyping of Toussaint and the way that he's been represented here. It's not that far away from what we would say is deeply offensive blackface. Or again, looking at these representations, the fact that even a heroic image of a black man would have him unclothed and kneeling in this subjugated position. And what can we say about our contemporary racial debates in relation to this legacy, when even the progressive political forces that have arrayed themselves around this question have been guilty of certain kinds of stereotyping and racism? And I think that's the kind of informative work that people who operate in a design and decorative arts context can contribute, frankly, because it is precisely the everyday nature of these objects, the fact that they were widely distributed, the fact that they cannot be securely identified or ascribed to one single author, that makes them powerful because they seem to speak to a reality that even the greatest individual artwork does not in the same way, because of course it represents that one artist's perspective. Just one last thing on this point would be another exhibition that was done at the Milwaukee Art Museum actually after I left, but by close colleagues of mine who I had worked with on the Toussaint Louverture show. And this was done with the artist Theaster Gates, who was intrigued by this object, which is by the figure who is normally called Dave the Potter, David Drake. And you may know about him, a great mid-19th century potter who often inscribed poetry into his objects, but was enslaved himself and was employed on the pottery of this plantation in South Carolina. And Theaster Gates in this project took a kind of somewhat whimsical, but again, very strongly politicized view of these historical objects and himself made artworks in response to them. So for example, he created a fictive organization called the Association of Named Negro American Potters. The point here being that Dave is one of the only people whose names we have, but that many, many other pots from the context of the South in America in the 19th century were probably also made by enslaved hands. And of course, that would be true of many other material culture artifacts from that context as well. And he also made this sort of pseudo Japanese ink painting, with which I will conclude my prefatory remarks here. And as you can see, he has written on it, "Bitch, I made this pot." And so what he's thinking about here is his own authorship as a contemporary artist, analogizing that in some way, and also juxtaposing his identity and subjectivity to the workmanship, craftsmanship, and also literary qualities of Dave's pots. And again, I would suggest to you that this is a kind of maneuver that is not possible outside of the context of material culture, because it is the very tacit qualities of material culture, the ways in which they do not speak to us, the fact that they often do not come with secure authorship, the fact that they are functional, the fact that they have a kind of quotidian status, that is the very aspect of them that allows us space to operate, allows someone like Theaster Gates or Barbara Bloom with her silhouettes, or the Musée de la Chasse. It gives that kind of, it's almost like the white space on a canvas that allows you room to maneuver. And I think for that reason, the current post-disciplinary environment in which we live has a real opportunity to completely rethink the way that decorative arts, design, and craft are being understood. As Etienne mentioned at the beginning of his remarks, I really think of these terms best used not as categories, but as themselves objects of use, as verbs, as things to apply, as things to experience on an ongoing and changeable basis. So rather than having a craft department where you have glass and ceramics and textiles, all of which are made for useful purposes, I think that we should encourage curators, directors, others in general to rather think of craft as an active term of debate and engagement through the entirety of the museum. So if we were to go over to the Louvre, I think that we should understand craft as something that is equally relevant in the 19th century French sculpture gallery, in the Chinese ceramics gallery, and in the Italian paintings gallery. It's present everywhere you go in that building, and I think it's a great mistake to frame it as only relevant in one context and not in others. I think that reproduces certain power asymmetries from the past, which is another thing we might get onto. The fact that craft has often designated the creative work of women, of non-white people, of non-Euro-Americans. But also, in addition to reproducing that historical set of asymmetries, I think that the designation of craft as a category, as a fixed framework, blinds us to the interpretive possibilities and also the modes of engagement that we might undertake with audiences in ways that will be far more relevant to them, far more meaningful to them than simply giving them a screen on which they can navigate to the next object that might catch their eye. So that's what I had to say, and now I'm going to turn it over to Olivier.
Thinking about the title of this discussion, Enduring Borders, I was thinking by myself coming here tonight that I'm the very lucky director of a museum where this question of border was not such a question for one century and a half. I think that really at the core of this museum is the question of the object and the making of the object, and whatever is the producer, whatever is a designer, whatever is a craftsman or craftswoman. I think that it's one of the strengths of this institution that all these categories are not so relevant. I would say it's perhaps also because the political environment of the foundation of the museum is a bit different from what you talk about, the Cooperative Museum or some other museum of decorative arts in Europe, for example, or even in Paris with our neighbor museum. It's not a state or national museum. It was not decided by a king or an emperor or a French president in his office. It was decided by a community of people and designer, collectors, craftsmen, manufacturer, with a big highlight and big importance of women inside the institution. We just opened last week a small but very, very powerful exhibition on the place and the role of women inside our institution for one century and a half. And I think it makes perhaps the context and the background and framework very different from many other museums. I realized a few weeks ago, talking with some of my colleagues in Europe, that many of the museums that were presented were conceived by government. And I think it makes a big difference because it came from the makers in a way. So the question of border was not so much a question. It was always much more a question of the object itself, the way you design it, the way you produce it, the way you communicate it. I don't know if it's the term is right, but the way you diffuse it and you transmit it to a much broader audience. And I think that makes a big difference. I'm always, as a curator, I'm not a very intellectual person. So I always start from the objects themselves. I think that's why I love to do my job in a museum. And I'm always fascinated by the fact that we are able to put so much concept and notion by some very simple object designed or done by people who had certain lot of all this notion behind the head. So I'm always very careful to go back to the objects themselves. And I think that the Musée des Arts Décoratifs in Paris is really I think is really identified by people and by the team, I would say, through this notion. You were very nice enough to talk about the Esprit du Bauhaus. There is some people here involved in this exhibition because it was I was just like the general curator. It was done by Anne Monnier, Raphael Biel, Louis Curtis, and many others. I would say that perhaps if we had this different approach of the Bauhaus. It was a young team, a younger team than usual. I will not say that I'm young, but they were young. And I love the fact that they really decided to start from the object. And I think it was very relevant for the museum, and this is certainly why it was so well received by the people and the audience, is that to make people comfortable. And I was very interested by the reaction of many of our colleagues. I will not give names and drop names, but being like, oh, it's not the way you usually done with Bauhaus, you know, because, well, they were surprised to see some very strong objects, not necessarily identified as Bauhaus objects, by a wider audience. And perfectly clearly, everything came from Bauhaus students and Bauhaus teachers. Mm. Nothing was invented by us. We just came from the objects themselves. And I think that doing this exhibition was for me like to renew with a very old tradition of the museum. And perhaps we have some images. First, because we decided to talk about the Bauhaus as a school, and I think that was perhaps very simply done, but very clearly and like a statement. Bauhaus is not a movement. I'm always, and I know that Anne and Louise and Raphael were very passionate about it. The fact that Bauhaus is sometimes like a tag you put on a building, you put on a movement, you put on a style, but it's not that. It's a school, so it makes a big difference. And it was also a way for us to go back to our roots. I mean, a museum and museum like a school, and you are here. One of the first images we have from the museum, which was at the start very interesting, was like a big art library. Very few to do with the object, very few objects at the really start of the museum, but a sort of very open library, open late at night, Place des Vosges, it means really at the heart of the Paris craftsmanship and creative industry of that time. With no difference between the people, I mean, young cabinet makers working for a small workshop or people working for a very larger manufacturer. So nothing of this border really at the beginning, like open resources. And I like the idea because it's, in my point of view, like in the VNA, a very strong because a very modern contemporary notion. So that's what's interesting for me. And you see that in the plan of the first Musée des Arts Décoratifs, in a way. So the library is really at the core of this institution, and I think that's important because even physically today, in the composition of the building, the foundation of the building is the art library, and I like this idea. Just also to precise that last year, the library joined the museum as an entity of the museum for the first time for the last 150 years, we were separated, almost not talking to each other, with different curators. And there was some Homeric struggle in the 50s and 60s between François Maté and Michel Faré, one the head of the museum, the other head of the library, with Homeric struggle about who is doing what and what's on. So that's over, and we are back to the history of the museum, of the institution, is bringing education and transmission through artworks or through documents. And in that way also there is not so much difference between the two. Of course, as soon as the museum opened, we are in this actual building since 1905, so it's very recent in a way. So you have to imagine that for 40 years, it was like a nomadic museum. Mm-hmm. Nomadic museum. We don't know very much about it. Sébastien, with really one of the one who knows very well the story of the institution. We don't know very much about the storage where, physically and logistically speaking, where all these artworks and collection. But I love the way that it came from a place to another in Paris, and especially what we call the Palais de l'Industrie. And you have here a very relevant vision of this kind of collection display, very close to the VNA, and sometime very close to what you find again in some very old and traditional museum, in a way that it's kind actual, the way you offer a lot of things. And I like the ideas of a generous museum. When I arrived 3 years ago, 3 years and a half ago, I really discussed with the team the fact that we have to bring more artworks in the galleries. We are not the Louvre. We are not the Département des Objets d'Art du Louvre, with this very special and specific history and provenance. I mean, in the Louvre, you have everything related to very strong historical core. At our museum, it's more about typology, I would say material culture. Mm-hmm. So you have to be in a very different approach. And I was disturbed when the museum reopened more than 10 years ago to see that the choice of displaying the artworks was very close to one of the Louvre, mm-hmm. with some masterpieces in very isolated showcases. And I think it doesn't make sense. We have to be in profusion. Mm-hmm. That's why I love in the Bauhaus exhibition that we were able to gather around 800 artworks for the exhibition. That's why I love in the Gutierrez exhibition we'll open in 2 days that we have 100 drawings of the 18th century. I love this idea because that's really the identity of the museum, and that's also another way to undoing these borders that is at the core of our discussion. So here you have all this display. I don't know if I regret them, but I love them very much, because you have this kind also of welcoming the visitors with a huge range of artworks, even textiles, even graphic design and graphics and drawings, things that we are used to eat today. And I think that's important for us to think about it. It's also interesting to see that really at the core, at the start of the museum also, due of the nature and the history of the museum. I always say that we are a collection of collection, something I like very much. Many of the collectors funding the museum were collector of painting, sculpture, objects, and in a way made no difference between them. So why we should add borders where there were no borders at the origin of the museum? I think it's another very important fact to understand. And you have here, for example, some rooms related to the legs Emile Bert. Emile Bert was a great collector, gave a huge and a dealer also, and gave to the museum a huge part of his own collection. Really important for today, and especially for the more classical collection. And I think that when you see that, it can seem very classical. It can seem very like period room. You can feel that you are in American museum at the same time. And I like also the idea, because the Louvre was not on this display. And I think there is certainly, I'm not smart enough, but there is certainly someone very mutual and very common to a shared process between the Musée des Arts Décoratifs and some Anglo-Saxon museum, because the part, this crucial role of collectors, much more than in the Louvre, where you have, in a way, a more national and a political vision. And that's true, you can be somewhere else, you can be in Philadelphia or Boston at the same time. I love this idea, and I think that we have also to be very careful to respect also this part of history, because period rooms were not conceived to be like very chic and Upper East Side or 7th arrondissement display. When you look carefully through the writing of Fitz Kimball or people like that, it was really to allow people to travel around the world. So today can be out of fashion because we can travel around the world through our iPhone. But for this period of the history, it was so important to make people able to travel by themselves, mm-hmm. and to experience something related to history and related to also a certain way of life. And that's why I'm always careful, especially at the museum, to respect this tradition of the museum. I think that it's not certainly relevant for more contemporary items, but I think that for middle age, 17th, 18th century, 19th century, early 20th century, it's very relevant. And we don't have to play too much with that, with a kind of despise, because it's very easy for people. It's not so easy, and it's always a huge experience for people, and that's why also all these rooms are so popular here and in many other collections. So you talk about our colleague from the Cooperative Museum. Mm-hmm. I think that I would have perhaps tried to underline this aspect. Mm-hmm. You are not in a Carnegie house for free, you know. You have to accept this place. If you don't like it, you find another building in New York. But I think that you have to play with that, because it's not so easy. And I think it means a lot for a lot of people. And when you talk about democracy, democratization, globalization, and the fact that, as you told, and I totally share your feeling, all this new media and digital and so on, feeling that it's democratic, but perhaps a period room is much more democratic than some screen you play with, because you need to have the material, and we take for granted that the material is open to everyone, which is not absolutely the case. A period room in a museum is it's a very open space, and I think that sometimes contemporary is not where you try to find it. That's why I love to keep this spirit. I go a bit quicker. I would say that you see that through the centuries, through the decades, it's a common line of the museum. I think that's an important point for us. I would say also, and I would like to underline the role of someone very important for the institution, because when you talk about a drawing border and you question the relationship between art, craft and design, I would say that we have also here in the heritage of a great personality of the French Museum, I would say of the worldwide museum. It's not very well known outside France, I fear, even if Harald Zeman paid homage to him several times. It's François Maté, who was director of the museum for almost 30 years. You have to remember that for a great part of his directorship, the Pompidou Center did not exist. The Musée d'Art Moderne de la Ville de Paris was still a bit classical, except Pierre Gaudibert and Suzanne Paget upstairs in L'Arc. There were very few rooms for really contemporary experience of art. And François Maté was someone very open-minded. Sometimes he was caricatural, like someone very open to contemporary action and nothing to do with heritage. It's totally fake. The same year of 1960, you have the great Jean Dubuffet retrospective, the first Dubuffet retrospective ever in France. And the same year, you have the huge exhibition devoted to Louis XIV, which is, again, a model of the genre in the history of decorative art. So he was someone able to deal with all that. And what is very interesting for us, I think, is that even he was the founder of the Centre de Création Industrielle, who is now in Beaubourg, a very passionate defender of the designers and the contemporary design, he was undoing the borders, and 30 or 40 or 50 years ago, because he played with this very simple notion, but very universal notion of object. And he was passionate about object. He did wonderful show. I mean, when you look through his bibliography and the list of the exhibition he organized for the museum, it's quite marvelous and astonishing to see, to realize how much he did with so few means at the same time, opening the categories and playing with these borders again and again. And here you have a good example with this fantastic and very important exhibition called Artiste Artisan. I think we are really at the core of the subject, of the topic. And we are in the late 70s, you know, so it's okay. It was 40 years ago, and we are trying to get back to this point. It was one of his big questions. He did exhibition called The Object. A bit later, he did this great exhibition on the métier d'art, was quite revolutionary because he mixed everyone together, porters, craftsmen, designer, painters, sculptor, and it was totally unusual. It was his own answer to the Centre Pompidou with this kind of ennoblement of the contemporary artist. And, painter, sculptor. I'm always surprised to see that sometimes it's still very important borders in the more contemporary centers. And it's fascinating to see that what we call in France les ringards are not necessarily where you are hoping to find the ringard. And I think that Maté was a very interesting guy because he was a great friend of Rothko, friend, as I say, of Harald Zeman. Really someone who I think assessed the role also of the curator in the very contemporary actual meaning of the world. And he was able to mix this image I love. You have here some beautiful mobile by Calder, and at a short distance, this very vernacular object, this kind of copper cork you put on the top of a church or a house, and making no difference, just the relationship with the spaces, the air, the movement. And I love the fact that it's very revolutionary, it's 40 years ago, and it's totally already undoing the borders. And I think that François Maté there were many great people after him, but he really shaped this vision and this identity of the museum. It was much attacked to be like to pay more too much attention to contemporary art. I think he was right. I mean, he was really at the core of our mission, and he really bring back the museum to this traditional identity of mixing the fields and undoing the border. And I think that in a way is someone very important for us today. I love the way there was this very fantastic reaction to the Spirit of Bauhaus show a few months ago. Last week I was very happy to see this same energy around this small but powerful exhibition called Travaux de Dame. I would say that it's a very homage paid to François Maté, because I think it's a very François Maté title. Mm-hmm. There is a question mark or early point, if you see, like a Agnès B mood. But it was the way, I mean, to assess and to question again and again the collection without playing too much with the concept and the intellectual notion, but to go directly to the right history and to objective facts of the history of the collection. I think that's very important, because in my experience of a director for the last 3 years, I'm surprised discussing with people and artists and craftsmen, women, with designers, to see that all this question of definitions and entities and borders actually is out of fashion for them. Mm. I think that as people looking, researching, trying to think about all that, we have to listen also to these people and to the artists, because they are far away. I mean, they are walking a bit faster than we are, and I think that they are already somewhere else. And I'm fascinating to see that, you know, as you say, sometimes decorative arts museums are a bit marginal. I'm always asked about it as a director since I arrived, because we are a small part of the palace. You have the huge palace, the Louvre, you know, huge history, nobility, regalian attitude, and we're on the margin of the palace, you know, and I always say we are like the enfant terrible. We don't care, and as you say, nobody cares, so let's have fun, because in a way, I mean, we don't have the same issues at the Musée du Louvre, just at the next door. You know, it's a big and big and overwhelming labor. We don't have the same issue. We don't have the same problem. So let's have fun about it. And I'm very happy to realize that today, many of the notions that we have and are really at the core of this question of undoing borders are totally related to contemporary creation. The question of decorative, I mean, the décoratif. Mm. When you talk with a lot of artists, it's a very contemporary issue. Yeah. When you talk with Johan Cretin or Jean-Michel Autoniel, it's really at the core of their work. And when you talk about the question of ornament, when you talk about the question of the object, and the object is everywhere in contemporary art, everywhere, in a way that we have to, you know, we have to touch that and to realize that, thinking about categories, all these creators are very avant-gardist in comparison with us, and they did great part of the way to that, and I think that's very important. And also, I realize it talking with a lot of designers today, and we show some of them. I think that we have. I love this view. We have a wonderful Vera Zekeli installation for the exhibition Les Métiers d'Art, and one of the display in the nef. The nef was separated in the eye. And I'm always surprised. Here you have the mutation. This exhibition we did with Les Métiers d'Art 2 years ago. Actually interesting, because I was surprised that some craftsmen of craft movement thought it was important to be overwhelmed by notion and concept. And conceptual attainment to be interesting. And I was very surprised about it, because I think it's another no issue way. Like people, you know, the Palais de Tokyo did few exhibitions on that question of craft. And I was always surprised to see that if it's like you need to have a lot of philosophical references and intellectual references to look at the object. Mm. You know, if you don't say Deleuze or Guattari, you cannot look at a table. And I think I told to some people, like designer or craftsmen, I say, well, do you need really that? I mean, you are one of the few people who are able to talk by yourself because you say something very universal. So get rid of that. It's ridiculous. You don't need that. And I love the idea when it's a very contemporary attitude. I remember when the Musée d'Armodin de Paris did this beautiful exhibition on tapestry and carpet, and contemporary textile. I remember the curator, she's a dear friend, she came to me one day for lunch, she said, "Oh, you know, Olivier, I just read this book by this fantastic guy called William Morris." And I said, "Okay, interesting, he's very fantastic, right? But, you know, it's very usual, I mean, it's very basic." And it was the same when there is this another version of the Fondation Bettencourt at the Palais Tokyo. People give you a book at the entrance of the exhibition. I remember I left with a book in my pocket. I didn't look at it. And the day after I looked at it, it was Henri Faucillon, La Vie des Formes. And I said, well, get it. What's the problem with that? I mean, it's an object of beautiful or useful, but do we need all these categories around? And I think that's important for us because today, and I would like to underline two very recent acquisitions of the museum through the help of our patrons and a special committee for design acquisition. You know, here you have Benjamin Grandorge and Christine McCurdy, two different generations, a man, a woman. And I'm sure that all these categories do not work for them. They are doing objects, they are doing art, they are expressing their own creation. I'm not sure they are so related to all this question of, you know, notion and framework or whatever. And I think that's very important, and that's also a big challenge for the museum today. We are starting the process to reshape all our galleries of 17th and 21st century design, to not say better. And the only request I had for the curatorial team was say, no, you mixed. You have textiles, you have wallpapers, you have photographs, you have drawings, you have craft, you have design, you have fashion. I think that to be modern today is to really undo these borders and to mix all that, because that's what makes sense. And for a museum like us, you know, it's a very competitive era, Paris, with a lot of other museums. Nobody are waiting for us, nobody are expecting anything from us. We are just struggling for life. And I think just express ourselves through things that nobody else is able to do. And I love the Musée Galliera, but Galliera is not able to display craft and design from his collection near his textiles and fashion collection. I love the Centre Pompidou, but Centre Pompidou is not able to display this collection of design, and he acquired very few craft. And I think that in 30 years, 40 years, will be difficult to talk about or age without talking about craft as a category, but they are not able to display textiles and fashion because they don't have it in their collection. So I think that really this question of undoing border today is really the big challenge, and I think it's more in our mind than in the objects themselves who talk for themselves. Yeah. That's why. Yeah. All right, to the fair.
Thank you very much. So I have a few questions. That was all very, very, very interesting and in two different ways. So for Glenn, I was curious actually about how much have you met difficulties in sharing your vision of craft with institutions and with universities too?
Yeah. Well, no trouble in universities. I think, as Olivier said, I think that we call them the next generation, whatever age they are, of artists. they're so uninterested in these questions of boundary and category that it's actually quite difficult to talk to them about it, because it's so irrelevant that, I mean, it's almost like trying to engage with a contemporary musician by talking to them about music from the 1920s and 30s. It's like the gulf is too big, and so you just have to skip it and go on to the next thing. So, you know, I was saying at the beginning of my talk that when you don't have these categories firmly set, you feel like you're not operating from a foundation at all. And I think that's really the position that these students are operating from. You know, when I was just at the end of the period when students could be motivated by their desire to overturn modernism or set categories, and that's no longer a possible motivation for these students. There's like no friction there. I think at the V&A also it was not really an issue because the V&A is a unique situation in being so completely comprehensive, and yet not having that national heroic quality of a kind of imposed ideology from the top that you were talking about with the Louvre. So, you know, their personality in a way, how can I put this? They were like the biggest enfant terrible ever invented. And that's sort of the psychology of the place. That's why they can do Alexander McQueen and David Bowie. It really fits them. So it was never a problem to talk about craft there. They just thought of it as part of what the V&A did. And it was in that situation. The Museum of Arts and Design was a completely different story, though. And since I have an ocean between me and them, I'll just be completely straightforward with you about what happened there. You know, I had an idea to direct that place towards precisely the kind of thing we're talking about, as being undifferentiated, but also being very focused on issues of making and craft, which is, of course, was the historical mandate of the institution, the founding mission. And they could do the undifferentiated part, but they couldn't do the core identity part. So the reason it's called the Museum of Arts and Design is because they wanted to be able to do everything, like the V&A does. But it is also because they were extremely uncomfortable with the concept of craft. You know, it used to be called the American Craft Museum, before that the Museum of Contemporary Crafts. And the fact that they, you know, I always said it was a name built around an absence, and it's like you could hear it in the room. It was literally like an elephant in the room, and you could almost hear it breathing, right? And it was the one no-go area for that constituency, and really here I'm talking about the founder, the board of trustees and the other patrons of the museum. And it was just very difficult to get anything going there that was not consumed with a kind of aspirational art status. So, you know, it's that paradox that you have to get around of, on the one hand, wanting to have it all and show art, design, historical crafts in the museum, but on the other hand, having this conception of what it would look like to have respect from the art world. And I think you just have to ignore that part of it. You have to say what we've been saying tonight, or what the Musée de la Chasse did. You have to say the terms on which we're going to get attention and respect are not going to be the established terms by which a conventional art museum would. You know, to me it's like, it's the power of being in the margin. This is the same reason that everything good about American music came from black people, because they were not in a position where they had to think about how the established power structure was going to reward them for their efforts, because they weren't being rewarded anyway. And I think, you know, not that I would ever compare decorative arts and the American black experience, although there's a lot of overlap there, but I would definitely say there's a power to operating in a margin if you can be very canny about it.
So have you met the same fear, I would say, in other American institutions?
Yeah, the problem with most American institutions is that they are they're gigantic boxes that have lots of little boxes inside them. So they're just as divided up as department stores. Yeah. And it's for the same reasons. You know, there's a conception that if you're running a department store, you need to know where you put the shoes and where you put the perfume, both for the audience and for the curators, right? So the Met, the Philadelphia Museum of Art, the Boston MFA, which I mentioned, Chicago, all these big museums, they're very, very balkanized, divided up. And that's so difficult to get over. It was difficult for the V&A as well. They eventually managed to transcend that.
So do you think that only small institutions allowed this kind of discussion?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. It's much easier when you...
Like the Musée de la Chasse.
Yeah, you know, to some extent that's just the conventional thing about the... or maybe Bordeaux. you know, in some ways it's just the conventional thing about the speedboat and the freighter. You know, you can turn faster. But I think it's also that there's just a physical, logistical infrastructure that is built according to an old model that is very, very difficult to overturn conceptually as well. Because as I keep saying, it's not like by getting rid of the boundaries you are immediately gifted some new idea to build your identity around. That was the problem with MAD. It was very easy for them to get rid of craft. The problem was replacing it. And similarly, if you decide that you're no longer going to organize your museum according to French painting versus Italian painting, painting versus sculpture, fine art versus decorative arts, if you just jettison that whole rubric, what are you going to do? What is your new rubric going to be? It's not at all clear. And you've given some good examples of how you might do that. But, you know, I would argue that it would be just as easy to do something like that example that you gave of the metal weather vane cocks as compared to the Calder. I agree with you that that's brilliant curating, but I think you could do some terrible curating in exactly the same spirit. It takes a kind of insight and depth of expertise and creativity to be able to pull off that kind of maneuver, whereas it probably doesn't actually take that much insight, depth of expertise or creativity to put the Italian paintings in one room and the French paintings in another. So it's you're asking a lot more of the museum's curatorial persona and staff when you take that kind of step. Well, maybe the same amount of effort, but differently directed, and more. It certainly takes more invention. Yeah.
So for Olivier, yes, Glenn showed various propositions about like how to enhance the experience of the visitors. So all with what we've seen, like at the Cooper Hewitt, for example. And so what do you think about these technologies? I mean, you've talked a bit about that, but I'm curious to know more about your feeling.
Well, all my team will tell you that I'm not a very technological boy. I know it's important, but I'm definitely bad at it. Very, very bad at it. And I would say that what impressed me and in a way what comforted me and reassured me, I worked for, as you say, for almost 6 years on a project called Le Louvre Abu Dhabi with a model of globalized museum in the world of today. And what people asked was, real artworks, of course, some elements to help you, and some mediation, and going through new technologies, of course, but the real work. And I remember when I entered in this project, and there is Peter who was part of it, in a way also, as a member of the acquisition board, I was very shocked by all the violence and the polemic around this museum. And I understood it in a way, because you have to be very open-minded, so I understood it. But I always told people, well, I mean, these people, in a way, defend a certain vision of the museum that we totally share. I mean, a real place, we're a real collection. So I think that I will not do Benjamin de Bal, as we say in French, but this real presence of objects, I mean, something very, for me, something very reassuring. And I have to say that we did a kind of the same meeting 2 years ago in New York with our colleague Caroline Bowman, the director of the Cooper Museum. And I remember I came to see her after to see the new museum. And she gave me this fantastic pen that you. Yeah. And you know, she gave it to me and I was like that. So I was very polite. And as soon as she left, I put it back on the bag. And I said, I want to see artwork. So I'm not the right visitors. I understand that it can be very helpful for people. But I totally share your approach. It's just to give people the experience that they can get very comfortably in their home, on their sofa. No way. I think that we have to do something more. And I think that, of course, you can be reactionary and look at all these people going to museum and say, ah, that's new consumerism, it's tourism, and blah, blah, blah. But in a way, you have to be also quite optimistic and positive. It's the fact that people came to see that. They could just say, okay, that's fine, I have the image on my iPad, and that's okay. And they, at the end of the day, they want anyway to see the real things. And I think it's important. I was always surprised when I work at the Musée d'Orsay to meet so many people looking at some important impressionist painting. Is it the real painting? You know, that's interesting. When people ask you the question, it was not, stupid people. It was people coming from time to time to the museum, not perhaps aware as we are around this room, but asking the question, I say, wow. So we have to tell them it's real, so that's a real experience. And that's important, it's the effort. So all regarding technology, I mean, we are working on this new display of our collection, so I say as a team, because I'm not a technological boy, but I'm aware of the importance of technology, I say, you have to think about it. I saw some elements and some, I would say, structure in the past few years in some museum I like, but definitely will not be the fantastic magic pen of the Cooperate Museum, because I don't understand. I mean, I'm perhaps too old or too young or too reactionary or too conservative or not enough or whatever, but I don't understand. And I think that it's drawing your question of undoing borders.
And people came to see that kind of artworks. They want to know about the materiality. They want to know about the experience. They want to know about the people who did it and so on.
Yeah.
And at the end of the day, to be in front of the artwork, it's one of great part of the answer.
Yeah.
So I'm very careful. I think that's important, but not too much and not overwhelming.
Yeah, the technology can create a new border. That's what you...
Yeah, and go to... I mean, I love to take picture with my iPhone in museum like everyone. Instagram, I like it and so on. But I look at the people and sometimes I look at myself and say, oh, you are totally around that. So it's like a new drug. So sometimes it's nice and it's even more dangerous. It's more risky. And we have to make people realize that it's risky to be alone in front of an artwork. And I think that's really like I'm doing that job. I think that's why it's acting.
Maybe more specifically, before giving the questions to the public, how do you explain that François Mathé's approach to works of art did not continue for like the 30 next years?
Well, I don't know. It's very, very difficult to know. I think it was a very singular personality and character of the French Museum and European Museum. I think he has this kind of freedom that perhaps the system today does not allow so much. And I think that that's a more tricky part of the role of any curator or director of institution is at one point to take some risks or to let people around you and to take risk for yourself. I think you have here the team of the Bauhaus exhibition. We took some risk. They took some risk. And my role was to say, okay, that's risky, but let's do it that way. And at the end of the day, I think that perhaps it was easier in the 50s, 60s, 70s, early 80s to be risky and free than today. So it's another big lesson for us, and we believe that we are always at the edge of everything. Perhaps François Mathé has much more freedom than I have. He has some difficulty, I know, by his... I had lunch last week with his daughter. I know he, at the end of his life and his directorship, he has an awful relationship with the board of trustees. He was closed in his office. He won't want to speak to anyone because he hated the Enarch and the administration and so on. Stupid people knowing nothing about museum, artworks and so on. It was certainly right, actually. But today the world is different. I cannot propose to my board to do an exhibition of 1 month long with a few things arriving from Scandinavia with no budget. And I mean, all this world changed a lot. And I think that's the same in Contemporary Art Museum when you believe that, when you realize that Suzanne Paget was able to do some Kounelis exhibition in the 70s, going with her car, picking some artworks, going to the galleries and so on. You cannot do that today. You have all the system, you have the insurance company, you have the galleries, you have...
Can I say something about that? I just wanted to react to that picture in particular, because if you look at that display of those roosters or cocks, if you were to see something like that today in a museum,
you would
think that has to be a contemporary art installation, because no museum with any self-respect would make something that cheap looking.
Yeah.
And with these little signs, and I mean, no money has been spent there at all, but it's great. And it's like we've been imprisoned by our own production values on a certain level.
May I have a parenthesis? We did this show called Travaux d'Âme. It's around 400 meters square. Raphael, something like that, and 200 objects, and I cannot tell you what it cost. Nothing, really nothing. And everybody is very impressed, and the journalists love it.
So there is always, there is still a path for creativity. Yeah. It's a small margin where we can, we cannot do that in the lab. We can do it with a fashion show because we need to do it. But for this kind of exhibition, I mean, that's the way we did it for almost nothing, and with the help of some generous patrons who trust us and believe in our willingness to do something. But at the end of the day, I mean, I will not dare to underline this question to my board of trustees, because they would say, you can do for nothing an exhibition. sometimes you need more money. But you see, and I think that I love this exhibition because it's very close to the François Mathé spirit. And I think that that was the way they were used to produce exhibition, in a very family-like way, with young people full of energy saying, oh, let's do that, and so on.
Yeah.
Well, thank you. So do you have questions?
Hi, is that working? Yeah. Right. I'm Stéphane Laurent. I'm from University of Sorbonne, Pantheon Sorbonne. I'm the head of the Art and Industry Program, Degree of Arts, Fashion and Design. So I have a question for both of you. To Mr. Glenn Adamson, it looks that you have a very top vision and looking straight forward. What should be a new display in a museum for exhibitions or for curating? So I was wondering if that made some issue regarding your decisions you made when you directed the museum in New York. And is that something that today looks realistic? Are there some other more commercial realities and ways to make the things? And to Olivier Gabet, just wanted to ask about the possible evolution of Museum of Decorative Arts. You're the director of these museums since about 3 years, 4 years now. And it looks that you feel a little bit desperate. I don't know, this is a bad impression. So it looks like the Louvre or Orsay are far beyond, and you cannot reach. Do you think there is a possible big improvement, and to make the museum being one of the craziest one in Paris and compete with the V&A in London?
You first.
What an incredible set of questions. Thank you. So I think you're right that a lot of what I was trying to do at MAD was, you used the word tough, which is an interesting word. I was also sometimes accused of approaching the job too intellectually, which might be more because I came from a scholarly background than the fact that I was actually trying to propose certain things. The way that I would frame it is that museums in general right now are under a lot of pressure to do things that will be successful in a situation that's also very risk averse. And I think if you don't have an obvious way to be successful, then that creates a very difficult situation. So there are some museums that can be successful no problem, just by making what you might call path of least resistance kinds of decisions. You know, so if you have a large Impressionism collection, put on an Impressionism show and you're pretty sure it will be successful. I would say MAD didn't really have that kind of an option open to it, because its traditional strengths of craft history were not evidently going to make the museum strong. And it also had no strong constituency in the contemporary art field, which it had been aspiring to. So the way that I would frame the challenge for that museum is that they literally have to invent something that will operate successfully in the 21st century. They've put themselves into that situation. Now, by the same token, I think that makes them one of the most exciting museums in America, potentially, because they don't have a backup plan, you know, which necessarily forces creativity. I think what will eventually happen there is that it will kind of lock in and move forward, and I hope that when I was there, I put some elements in place that will help it to do that. But I sort of accept the criticism, but with the caveat that I think what would be commercially successful in a museum like that is quite hard to say, actually. And so I'm looking very curiously to see what the next chapter will hold for them.
To me. I'm not at all desperate. Actually, I love really much my museum. I'm not sure to be too arrogant, but I think that I am one of the directors that very happy to be director of the museum. I remember when my chairman appointed me 3 years and a half ago, he told me, what do you want to do next? And I say, perhaps I always say what I want to do now, because perhaps too many directors in this museum thought about what they will do next and focus all about that. And I think that I'm a decorative arts specialist, so-called specialist, so that's my field and I like it. In regard of the comparison with other museums, I totally agree with you. I think it's, in a way, it's a question of scale. When you say to compete with the V&A, for me, it has no sense. And I remember that when I arrived, Jean-Jacques Aragon quit, and we have a new chairman, a great banker, and I learned a lot of with him, Bruno Roger. And he was, at the beginning, telling me, oh, but we are the French V&A, we should do that, do that, do that. So I went to the V&A and I meet Martin Roth. I love very much, very, very much, he's a dear friend. And I say, okay, you would like to be elected as a trustee of the board of the Musée des Décoratifs to explain them that we are not the same thing? So he accepted it. He went to the board, actually he left, he left the directorship of the V&A. And I regret it very much. And he explained them what I tried to explain them, but I was perhaps too young or not enough confident. And what he explained them, it was totally another story. Mm. It was not a community of manufacturers who did the V&A. It was the political, side, and a strong statement in a way. That first. It was in a specific building, which was not our case. And if you want to be very close to the reality of the V&A, you get the Musée des Décoratifs and you add a part of the Louvre, a part of the Musée de Cluny, a part of the Musée du d'Orsay, a part of the National Library, a part of whatever, and that we are not that. So we have this specificity. And actually, I feel totally comfortable in this museum and what it is, what we represent today. I totally agree with you. We are not compete in the same stage, so it gives us more freedom. Yeah. And I love the parallel you did with minorities. So-called minorities, but it's true. You have to reinvent yourself, you have to be more confident, you have to be more imaginative, more creative. We had a huge success, I mean, perhaps not regarding the number for a huge museum like the Louvre, but Bauhaus exhibition was a huge success, and I think that we did our way very differently than the Centre Pompidou would have done it, did it. And that's what I want to assess, that we have to be very proud of ourselves, not arrogant, but very proud of ourselves, to have our own little music. And I think that the team I gathered around me, I mean, there is a whole part of the team, there is new blood coming in the museum that they want to share. I mean, this mixture of generations is that we have all little music. And I would say that last year, in 2016, the big symphony orchestra around us suffered a lot. And with our little own music, we jumped from 124% more of attendance after two or three very difficult years, where the board was very almost panicked by the numbers, by the financial state, the teams were very put under pressure. We rebuilt it together, and I think we are now at the right average. And I told my board of trustees, don't dream of 2 million people. It would be bad. I prefer to be my museum with 600,000 people every year. We cross the door knowing what they want to know, what they want to find. I always say to my board, perhaps less people at the Louvre, but I think that people are more informed, more trained. They want to know. They will perhaps learn a lot of things that they don't expect, but it's a true experience. I was curator of the Musée d'Orsay. I'm not fascinated by, I love this museum. I work for the Louvre in a way, and a side way with the Louvre Abu Dhabi. I remember all my colleagues at the painting department, the kingdom of the nobility of the French Museum, saying, why are you doing a museum in Middle East? You know, they know nothing about art, they don't care. I say, do you go to the Grand Gallery? You listen to the people. They don't even know what they are looking at. Stop it. They are not able to explain and to understand which scene of mythology it is, historical, antique, and ancient history. People lose, I totally lost the keys. And what I love in my museum, I mean, everyone has his own problem, but in their own issues, but what I love in my museum is that at last, there is a sort of very strong universal basis that can be shared with a lot of people. We have Japanese people, Korean people, Chinese people, Arab people. They all understand what they are looking at. And I love that, because in a way, this is a very universal side of the job. So in a way, I'm not desperate at all. I'm very hopeful.
I just wanted to add one quick thing, which is that I think what you're hearing from Olivier, and maybe something what I'm saying too, is that when you don't have these overarching categories, the solution for each institution becomes incredibly specific, because there's no agreed upon set of standards. In a funny way, it's the same problem that we're experiencing in our political scenarios. There's no agreed upon standards of reference. But what that does for particularly a small museum, but I think any museum, is that their definition of artistic success would, by definition, almost only work for them. And that might be based on the collection, it might be based on the people in it, it might be based on something historical, it might be based on the bricks that the museum is made from. It could be based on anything, but it's going to be that very, very specific, particular thing that makes the place successful. It's not going to be doing a great version of what you can see in some other place, which is exciting.
Thank you. Do you have other questions?
Yeah, thank you very much to both of you for your thoughtful presentation. I'm a PhD student at École d'études en sciences sociales and an independent curator involved in books and textiles. I have two... Sorry? Yeah. I have two questions, so please feel free to pick up the one you prefer. My first question is about what we can call the anthropology of craft. So it's very clear from what you showed that the history of display is really important in contemporary curating, but I'm wondering if the next step could be what we can call, let's say, the anthropology of craft, both in terms of research and curating. And my second question is maybe a bit more personal. I'm wondering, in your own practices as curator, what's your relation with exhibition designers, what we call in French like scénographes, in a maybe old-fashioned way, considering that furnitures and displays are hugely important in the way we understand the objects that are on view. Thank you.
I can try to answer both questions at once in a way, because I think they relate to one another. So, you know, one thing you can say about a craft object, unlike a painting, is that it wasn't made exclusively to be looked at. So the minute you put it in a museum gallery, at a minimum, you're presenting only one of its guises, which is, again, why I started with the furniture you can actually sit on. So I think that imposes a specific set of challenges on exhibition design. And you know, from my point of view, it's great to just accept that that's what's happening, and again, be more scenographic than you would be with a painting. So a painting makes you feel like you need to respect its autonomy, but I don't think a decorative art object does that. And although you're also shedding a lot of things about it, like I can't drink out of it, you can be playful in a different way. And I think that leads directly to the possibility of being more anthropological. In fact, I think a lot of things can be learned by art museum curators from anthropology museum displays. And the specific thing that we did at MAD a great deal was actually put makers in the galleries and ask them to demonstrate the techniques that were used to create the objects just next to them. So we did, for example, an exhibition about a mannequin company run by somebody called Ralph Pucci, and we actually brought, we created a whole almost stage set version of his workshop, and then had one of his artists come and literally carve clay like he would to make a mannequin. And people loved that. They much prefer watching that to looking at a static object on a platform. So I think those things are very strongly correlated.
Yeah. I would say that for the anthropological side of your question, I mean, perhaps one of our great chance opportunity at the museum is that we have collection of design, craft, and fashion and textiles. Mm. And I think that we learn a lot from the fashion sides and textile sides because it's very strong. And what you say about the fantastic Rafpucci exhibition, I'm not a fashion specialist, but I'm always surprised when you go to the exhibition that some big monographic exhibition are not so successful, but people love when this anthropology side is strong, like we did just right now with Tony Collect Exigé and with some other. And I think that's very, 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 I mean, the place of humanity and mankind in that is very important. And just for, it's incredible to see what you put, a beautiful display, a wonderful dress, people will be all around the video showing the catwalk and the fashion show, because anyway, it's alive, and that's the reason. And I think regarding your question regarding scenography, for me, scenography is the first mediation. So scenography is not just about just fun, and to let the scenographer is totally freedom, is to make sense also for the audience, the future audience. And I think that it's we have a tradition at the Musée des Arts Décoratifs. It's not for me; it's very a long tradition. Of asking designer, theater people, architect to challenge this question of scenography. And I think that it's always the closer you are between the subject and the scenography and the spirit of scenography, the more efficient you are to, I mean, we are not doing exhibition just to have fun by ourselves. It's to share with the more important number of people. So, for example, I remember when we did the Fondacity exhibition, we did it with Barlaba Fondacity and he's one of his cousins. And at first step, I was a bit reluctant. It was, he wanted to do it, but I said, and actually, I went to the house of his father. I realized what was this practical madness was the subtitle of the exhibition. Mm-hmm. And I said, okay, it's not totally free hand, but let's do it together in the way you want it. And the exhibition, I mean, expressed this madness through the accumulation of objects and so on. On the other hand, when we did the Bauhaus show, the answer of the scenographer was a little challenge between several people. And the answer we chose was very tight relationship with the topic of the exhibition itself. What is a school? What is an art school? What is an art school like, you know, the home for modernity? And in a way, I mean, Laurence Fontaine play very, very carefully and very smartly with the diagram of the teaching at the Bauhaus and the color diagram, and she did something very thoughtful. People say, "Oh, it's too directive," but in a way, it was also we want something very didactic because it was the Battle School, so it has to be also relevant regarding that.
Yeah, I always think you should have the exhibition designer at the first meeting.
Sorry?
You should also always have the exhibition designer at the first meeting.
Yeah.
About the exhibition, if you can.
Well, I want to thank Olivier, Glenn, Etienne, and also Constance Moreto on our staff for organizing this event, and to all of you for coming. And I also want to say that we have objects made out of glass in the corridor which are meant to be used and not looked at, and so you're all welcome to join us for a glass. Thank you.